The scripture reading before the lesson comes from Acts chapter 1, verses 1 through 8. Acts chapter 1, verses 1 through 8. I'll be reading from the New King James. The former account I made, O Theophilus, of all that Jesus began both to do and teach, until the day in which he was taken up, after through the Holy Spirit he had given commandments to the apostles whom he had chosen, to whom he also presented himself alive after his suffering by many infallible proofs, being seen by them during the 40 days, and speaking of the things pertaining to the kingdom of God. And being assembled together with them, he commanded them not to depart from Jerusalem, but to wait for the promise of the Father, which, he said, you have heard from me. For John truly baptized with water, but you shall be baptized with the Holy Spirit not many days from now. Therefore, when they had come together, they had asked him, saying, Lord, will you at this time restore the kingdom to Israel? And he said to them, it is not for you to know the times or seasons which the Father has put in his own authority, but you shall receive the power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you shall be witnesses to me in Jerusalem and all of Judea and Samaria and to the end of the earth.
Several times in the New Testament, the Lord's people are admonished to speak the same thing. For example, Jesus prayed for that principle in John 17, verses 20 and 21. And the Apostle Paul wrote it clearly by inspiration of the Holy Spirit in 1 Corinthians 1 and verse 10. And there are several other times in the New Testament where we can glean from the text that we as the Lord's people, we all need to speak the same thing. Now that is especially true when it comes to the Holy Spirit. We all need to speak the same thing about the Holy Spirit. And in order to speak the same thing about the Holy Spirit, the only way I know to do that or with any other Bible doctrine, it involves communication. And communication is at least twofold. Someone has to speak, but someone else has to listen. So if the speaker does his part, but the listener doesn't do theirs, there's no communication. If the listeners do their part, but the speaker doesn't do their part, there's no communication. So let's talk today about Holy Spirit baptism. Is Holy Spirit baptism promised to everyone for all time? Or was it limited in both its recipients and its scope? I'm going to declare a sentence unto you that I'll probably say several more times throughout this sermon. Holy Spirit baptism was a promise of power received by a precise group of persons for the purposes of communicating and confirming the Word of God, all within a very particular period of time. That's one sentence. And from that one sentence, there are five things that we want to talk about today regarding Holy Spirit baptism. So let's just begin. The first thing about Holy Spirit baptism we want to observe today is that it was a promise. Holy Spirit baptism was a promise. Now, run down this word promise in the first two chapters of the book of Acts and see what you come up with. I think you may be surprised when you actually do that. But let me give you a brief observation about promises. Promises are to be received and enjoyed. Do you understand that? You cannot obey a promise. You receive and enjoy a promise. Commands are that which are to be obeyed. Those which are to be obeyed. A promise is something that is received and enjoyed. However, many promises have conditions. Let me try to illustrate it. Very simply, Acts 2:38. Then Peter said unto them, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for the remission of sins. Even right there are two commands with a promise. But you can definitely see this, and ye shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. in order to receive in that verse the gift of the Holy Ghost, whatever you want to make it, you had to repent and be baptized. So there are promises with conditions. Now, John the Baptist clearly spoke of this promise. Turn with me to the book of Matthew, chapter 3. John the Baptist talked about the promise of Holy Spirit baptism. Matthew 3 and verse 11, picking it up in the middle of a thought, but I think you understand it. He says, I, that's John the Baptist, indeed baptize you with water unto repentance. There's one baptism in that verse. But he that cometh after me is mightier than I, whose shoes I am not worthy to bear. He, that's Jesus, he shall baptize you with the Holy Ghost. That's a promise. And John says that Jesus is the one who's going to administer it. But there's a third baptism in this verse, and with fire. For those who don't believe that this is a third baptism, run down the word fire in this context and see what you come up with. Fire is equal to punishment. You don't want to experience fire baptism. Now, John's baptism was limited in both its time and in its scope. Fire baptism is a promise that was only going to be administered by Jesus. Or Holy Spirit baptism was a promise that was only going to be administered by Jesus, and fire baptism is likewise, but it's punishment. Now you can also look at Mark 1:8, Luke 3:16, and John 1:31 and 32. John spoke of the promise of Holy Spirit baptism several times, as far as we can see, through the accounts of Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. But every time he made it clear, Jesus is the one. I baptize with water. That was John's baptism. Jesus is the one who's going to baptize with the Holy Spirit and incidentally with fire. But Jesus also spoke of this promise. Look back to our scripture reading in Acts chapter 1. First thing we're observing about Holy Spirit baptism, it was a promise. You do not obey promises. You receive and enjoy promises. That's key. But promises, some of them can have conditions. That in order to receive that promise, you must meet the conditions. Acts 1 and verse 4, the Bible says, and being assembled together with them, commanded them that they should not depart from Jerusalem. That's the command. What's the command? Don't depart from Jerusalem, but wait for the promise. Don't leave Jerusalem, but wait for the promise of the Father, which saith he, ye have heard of me. For John truly baptized with or in water, but ye, this is a promise, shall be baptized with the Holy Ghost not many days hence. Now, anyone who reads the Bible, do you understand that Jesus keeps his promises? He keeps his promises. He gave the command. Wait in Jerusalem. Don't leave Jerusalem. Tarry ye in Jerusalem. And what's the promise? You're going to be given Holy Spirit baptism. So there's the first thing. Holy Spirit baptism is a promise. Now here's the second thing. Holy Spirit baptism is a promise of power. Now let me read the sentence to you again. Holy Spirit baptism was a promise of power received by a precise group of persons for the purposes of communicating and confirming the Word of God, all within a very particular portion of time. So second, Holy Spirit baptism, let's talk about the power associated with it. When you read 1 Corinthians 2 and verse 4, Paul made it clear. There were demonstrations of the Spirit's power that you could say, yeah, I see that. There were things that could occur in the first century and you go, yeah, that is power right there. Look with me, if you would, in the book of Luke, chapter 24. Those who read the Bible, perhaps even leisurely, are going to understand that Luke and Acts are volume 1 and volume 2 of a 2-volume set. So Luke and Acts go right together. Now look at Luke 24 and verse 49. This is Jesus specifically speaking to the 11, but look at what the verse says. The Bible says in Luke 24, 49, and behold, I send the promise of my Father upon you, but tarry ye in the city of Jerusalem, look, until ye be endued with power from on high. Now, what does that verse tell us about this promise? It was a promise, but it was a promise of what? It was a promise of power. Do you see that? Now, go back to Acts chapter 1. Acts chapter 1 and verse 5 again. Jesus says, "For John truly baptized with her in water, but ye shall be baptized, immersed, overwhelmed with the Holy Ghost not many days hence." Now look down at verse 8. "But ye shall receive power." When? "After that the Holy Ghost has come upon you." Do you see that? Do you see that Holy Spirit baptism was a promise of power? This is key in understanding what it was. Now, I don't think anybody, just from looking at those texts, is really going to say, that's not true. Holy Spirit baptism was not a promise, and there was no power associated with it. You can't get past those. Holy Spirit baptism was a promise, and it was a promise of power, but what type of power was associated with Holy Spirit baptism? That's the question that we need to ask. And the clear answer to that question is miraculous or supernatural power. Now, how do you know that? Acts 1:5, baptized with the Holy Ghost not many days hence. Verse 8 of Acts 1, ye shall receive power. You understand? Now look at Acts 2 and verse number 4. We understand the individuals who were here, and we'll clear that up in just a minute. But we can see that when the power came upon these people, you can know that they were immersed with the Holy Spirit or the Holy Ghost. Now look at the type of power that was associated with this. Verse 4 of Acts 2. "And they were all filled with the Holy Ghost and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance." Now, the ability to speak in tongues was a miraculous or supernatural ability. Clearly. Now the question is, what were tongues? Well, we can read right through this context and determine what tongues were. Look at verse 6 of Acts 2. "Now when this was noised abroad, the multitude came together and were confounded." For what reason? "Because that every man heard them speak in his own language." Now in verse 4, they were speaking with tongues. In verse 6, the people say, "What is this? We hear these men of Galilee speaking in our own language." So what were biblical tongues? They were known languages. Somebody knew the language that was being spoken, or at least had the ability to know the language. Look at verse 11. "Cretes and Arabians, we do hear them speak in our tongues." Verse 4 is tongues. Verse 6 is language. Verse 11 is tongues. What's the difference? What's the difference? There is no difference. So what were biblical tongues? They were known languages to those who heard them, but the speaker had never studied them. Perhaps I could give you an illustration. Imagine hearing a Galilean speak flawless Latin. That would be a little strange. Well, how strange would that be? That would be like a good old Davidson County native speaking impeccable and flawless Japanese. Have you ever met a Davidson County man that speaks Japanese? I eat Japanese, but I don't know how to speak Japanese. Do you? That's the idea behind biblical tongues. It would be someone that you say, okay, I understand this guy's a Galilean, but he's speaking flawless Latin. How did this man receive that ability? Well, the answer is it was supernatural. Tongues were known languages that the speaker had never studied. When you look at 1 Corinthians 14 and verse 22, tongues were a sign for whom? Tongues were a sign for unbelievers. Why would that be? Imagine seeing a Davidson County man speaking flawless Japanese and Japanese being your native tongue. Or your native language. Would that get your attention? Do you think that would get your attention? Oh yeah, that's not going to necessarily happen today. If it does, it'll be because that individual has spent much time in study and practice of that language. But the apostles didn't have to put in study. And here they were showing the practice of that. How does that occur? It occurred supernaturally. Now turn with me in your Bibles, if you would, to 1 Corinthians 14 and verse number 2. 1 Corinthians 14 and verse number 2. There's some confusion that arrives about this because many of our religious friends try to tell us today that, okay, the only thing that's left are unknown tongues. Meaning what? I guess they think they're speaking in some kind of angelic language. Well, I got a question for you. Where did an angel ever come speak to a person where that person didn't say, yeah, I got it, I understand what you're saying? Where there was a communication barrier between an angel and a man. I haven't read that. Have you? Now, is there an angelic language? I don't know. But I know what I read in the scripture is that every time an angel communicated with the person understood exactly what they were saying. Is that what you read too? 1 Corinthians 14, 2. For he that speaketh in an, the King James translators added the word unknown. How do I know that? Because it's italicized. So they're saying this is not in the original text, but they've tried to supply this word to help give the understanding of the meaning. For he that speaketh in an unknown tongue. Now, is there a difference between unknown and unknowable? Do you understand? Is everything unknown, unknowable? There's a difference. Do you understand that? For he that speaketh in an unknown tongue speaketh not unto men, but unto God. For no man understandeth him. What does it say? For no man understandeth him. Howbeit in the spirit, that shows he's inspired, he speaketh mysteries. Now, unknown tongues in this context, this was simply an untaught and unstudied known language to human beings on this planet. Let me try to illustrate it again. Does anyone in here speak Japanese? I didn't say eat, I said speak. I don't think so. So let's say back in the first century, I had the supernatural ability to speak in tongues. And the tongues in which I could speak supernaturally was Japanese. Now I'm not saying Japanese existed then, I'm trying to illustrate. What good would it do for me to come up here and speak in the unknown tongue of Japanese and nobody in here speak Japanese? What good would that do? Now, when you read on, and many times the questions that come up from one verse are answered if we'll just keep reading. For the sake of time, read 1 Corinthians 14 and verse 5 and 1 Corinthians 14 and verse 28. With no inspired interpreter, no one could grow and benefit from the message. And the principle is, don't say it. The spirits of the prophets in this same chapter are subject to the prophets. Our religious friends think they're slain in the spirit and they have to shama lama lama la, whatever it is that they're up there muttering, some type of ecstatic utterance which has never been an intelligent language at any time on this planet. And they say that that is tongues. Friend, that's not true. Bible tongues were known languages. Sometimes those languages may not have been known to the hearers. And we'll read 1 Corinthians 12, 8 to 11 directly. And we'll see that God designed the church to be like a body. We need each other. There may be one who spoke in tongues, but then there will be another one who interpreted the tongues, and then the prophets were to judge what was spoken. So they'd say, yes, that's true. That the Bible teaches that. It wasn't just a one-man show for people to show off, but that's unfortunately what it ended up being, even in the first century. Now, number three, Holy Spirit baptism, and now let's talk about the precise people who received this promise. Listen to the sentence again. Holy Spirit baptism was a promise of power received by a precise group of persons for the purposes of communicating and confirming the Word of God, all within a very particular portion of time. Now, third, let's talk about the precise people, and let's simply let the evidence speak for itself. Okay? Go back to Acts chapter 1. I would highly advise you again to go back and read Acts chapter 1, verses 1 through 8, and see if this is correct or incorrect. Because I am asserting that Acts 1, 1 through 8 is an apostolic promise. And Holy Spirit baptism was a promise to the apostles of Christ. All right, let's begin the process. I've asserted it. Now let's see if I can give some evidence to substantiate that conclusion. Acts 1 and verse 1, the former treatise have I made, O Theophilus, of all that Jesus began both to do and teach until the day in which he was taken up, after that he through the Holy Ghost, pay attention, had given commandments unto the apostles. But the inspired writer qualifies it even more. The apostles whom he had chosen. Those are the apostles of Christ. Now you read on down, to whom, them, assembled with them, ye shall be baptized with the Holy Ghost not many days hence. Those are apostolic promises. Those are promises to a precise group of people, the apostles of Christ. In verse number 11 of Acts chapter 1, watch how the Bible qualifies itself and explains itself. These angels which also said, ye men of Galilee, ye men of Galilee. Those were the them and the apostles whom he had chosen in Acts 1, 1 to 8. Look at verse 13, you see a record of their names. There's the men of Galilee and their names that are given. And then in verse 26, you see that Matthias is numbered with the 11 apostles to take Judas Iscariot's place who fell by transgression. So there you have the 12 apostles, don't you? Now look at Acts chapter 2 and verse 7. Still flowing out from this same account. Acts 2 and verse 7, and they were all amazed and marveled, saying one to another, behold, now look at what they said. Are not all these which speak Galileans? Is that what they thought they were seeing? They thought all these people speaking in tongues, in their own languages, they looked up and said, are not all these which speak Galileans? So they sure thought that it was who? The 12 apostles. The 12 apostles whom Jesus had chosen. Now recall Luke 24, beginning in verse 44 and reading on down. All those things were apostolic promises. They were promises given not to the whole world, not to every member of the church, but to the apostles whom he had chosen. There were also apostles of the church. When you look at scriptures like Acts 14 and verse 14, incidentally, there were three types of apostles. There were the apostles whom he had chosen, that's the 12 plus Paul. Then you have apostles of the church, which were men like Barnabas. Barnabas had supernatural abilities, no doubt. But did he have Holy Spirit baptism? No, he did not. And then there were the apostles of God, Hebrews 3 and verse 1. See if you know who that individual is. Now, Acts 2, 1 to 4, when we run this down, it goes right back to chapter 1 and verse 26. It's the 11 apostles plus Matthias. Now, we can know that when the power came, the promise was fulfilled. But let me tell you another aspect about that promise of power. When the power came, the kingdom was established. Did somebody talk about that in the New Testament? Oh, yeah. You know what his name is? Jesus. Read Mark 9 and verse 1 when you get the opportunity. Jesus plainly said, some of you that stand here shall not taste of death till ye have seen the kingdom of God come with power. So when the power came in Acts 2, 1 to 4, there are several things that we can know. Number one, there's Holy Spirit baptism on the precise people, the apostles whom he had chosen, and we can know that right there, the New Testament kingdom was established. So do you see how many false doctrines just this simple sermon beats down? It beats them down. Because our religious friends say the kingdom is not here. Oh, yes, it is. It came when the power came. Well, where did the power come? Acts 2, 1 to 4. Holy Spirit baptism upon the apostles whom he had chosen. So there's one set, but there's no doubt. The apostle Paul experienced Holy Spirit baptism, perhaps at some point during the 3-year period recorded in Galatians 1, 15 to 18. It's very difficult to say Here's the scripture where I know and can read clearly that Paul underwent Holy Spirit baptism. That's difficult, but I'm going to tell you what's not difficult. It's not difficult to establish from the New Testament that Paul was not one whit behind even the very chiefest apostles. Now, what does that tell you? That tells you that Paul was an apostle of Christ, just like Peter, just like John, just like all the rest of the men whose names are recorded in Acts 1 and verse number 13. Now, it can be unquestionably proven that those who experienced Holy Spirit baptism possessed the power to confer miraculous gifts to others. I can prove that. Can you prove that? I know the individuals who experienced Holy Spirit baptism. Why? Because they could lay their hands on people and confer unto them miraculous gifts. This seems to be the proof, the absolute proof that an individual was an apostle of Christ. For the sake of time, we're not going to read them, but I hope you will write these down. Hopefully we're all familiar with them. In Acts 8, verses 14 to 19, Philip the evangelist possessed perhaps at least two supernatural gifts of the Spirit. But when it came to the ability to pass that gift on, he could not do it. They had to have the apostles, Peter and John, come to Samaria so that the Holy Spirit could be given. That is, supernatural gifts could be given by the hands of the apostles. Philip the evangelist had the power in that he could work miracles, but he could not place his hands on another person and confer miraculous gifts. There's evidence right there that that was proof that the apostles underwent Holy Spirit baptism. When you read Acts 19, verses 1 to 6, do you know what that proves? That's probably as clear a proof that you have that Paul was an apostle of Christ. Do you know why? He laid his hands on people and they could work miracles. They could do supernatural things after Paul laid his hands on them. So what does that tell us? Paul was a Holy Spirit baptized apostle of Christ. And that's why he said in 2 Corinthians 12 and verse 12, the Corinthians, the brethren there at Corinth, seemed to question his apostleship. And he said to them clearly, truly the signs of an apostle were wrought among you with all patience and in signs and wonders and in mighty deeds. And he's basically saying, look, if I'm not apostle, where'd you all get your supernatural gifts? Where'd you get them? If you didn't get them from me, then where'd you get them? So the 12, including Matthias, received Holy Spirit baptism. Paul, no doubt, received Holy Spirit baptism. But then some people are going to say that Cornelius and those of his house received Holy Spirit baptism. Look at Acts chapter 11. We talked about Cornelius with the gift of the Holy Spirit a few weeks ago. But Acts chapter 11 verses 1 through 18 is another orderly account of what happened at the household of Cornelius. Now look at Acts 11 beginning in verse 15. This is the apostle Peter speaking and giving an account of what happened at Cornelius' household. The Bible says in Acts 11:15, and as I began to speak, as Peter began to preach the gospel, the Holy Ghost fell on them as on us at the beginning. In this context, what would the beginning be? It would have to be Acts 2, 1 to 4, wouldn't it? Wouldn't you think? What was that the beginning of? There's the beginning of the kingdom. There's the beginning of the gospel, the beginning really of the new covenant established upon the blood of Jesus Christ. The Holy Ghost fell on them, Cornelius and his household, as on us at the beginning. The text says, then remembered I. What the meaning would be here is that what happened at Cornelius' household reminded Peter of what the apostles experienced in Acts 2, 1 to 4. Question, who laid their hands on the apostles in Acts 2, 1 to 4? No one. Who laid their hands on Cornelius and his household before they received miraculous gifts? No one. They came straight from God. Therefore, Then remembered I, that is, it reminded Peter, the word of the Lord, how that he said, John indeed baptized with water, but ye shall be baptized with the Holy Ghost. Now, based on that, some people feel that Cornelius and his household experienced Holy Spirit baptism. All right, look. Verse 17. Forasmuch then as God gave them the like gift. Does like mean exact same? Does like mean the exact same? No. But there was something similar about what happened at Cornelius' household as what happened to the apostles. What was it? Cornelius and his household received miraculous gifts straight from God, just like the apostles did. Forasmuch then as God gave them the like gift as he did unto us who believed on the Lord Jesus Christ, what was I that I could withstand God? Now let's assume for a second that Cornelius and others of his house did experience Holy Spirit baptism. Here's question number one. Could Cornelius and those of his household lay hands on others and confer miraculous gifts? Could they do that? If they could, where's the record of that? If you say that, okay, they had Holy Spirit baptism, but they couldn't lay their hands on others and confer miraculous gifts, okay, now you're in problem number two. Were there measures of Holy Spirit baptism? Huh? Were there measures of the baptismal measure of the Holy Spirit? Now, you may not understand that, but you ask yourself that question. Were there degrees of supernatural power? Yes. The baptism of the Holy Spirit was a degree of supernatural power. But were there degrees of that degree? Were there measures of that measure? Well, you're going to have to answer that. Now, when you look at Joel 2, verses 28 to 32, and Acts 2, 16 to 21, those are general prophecies. And they're general prophecies of supernatural gifts. And there's no doubt that the Gentiles were going to have supernatural gifts. Where do you see that fulfilled? Well, you can see it clearly fulfilled out the household of Cornelius. And you can clearly see that they were baptized in water for the remission of sins. So the Gentiles were made partakers of the gospel in that they were forgiven of their sins, but they were also made partakers of the gospel in that they received supernatural gifts directly from God. So I am of the persuasion that Cornelius and his household did not experience Holy Spirit baptism based on the fact that, number one, there's no evidence that they could lay their hands on anyone and confer miraculous gifts. And number two, I cannot find a scripture that clearly teaches that Holy Spirit baptism was promised to anyone other than the apostles whom he had chosen. Now, number four, Holy Spirit baptism, and let's talk about some of the purposes of this supernatural promise of power. We could say a lot about the Comforter in John 14, 26. And when you read John chapters 13, 14, 15, 16, and 17, guess what you have? They're apostolic promises. They're promises to the apostles whom he had chosen. But I want to quickly give you two things. Number one is communication. What were some of the purposes of Holy Spirit baptism? Number one, communication. Recall that those who experienced Holy Spirit baptism in Acts 2, 1 to 4, what was the first initial evidence that they had been given a promise of power? They spoke with tongues. What were tongues? They were known languages. Now think clearly about this. The apostles were given a very specific commission. Are you familiar with where it is? One of them is recorded in Mark 16, 15. Jesus says, go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. Question, could everyone in the whole world speak the same language? So what did Holy Spirit baptism enable the apostles to do? As they went out preaching the word, guess what they never had? They never had a language barrier. There was never a group of people, never a tribe, nowhere, anywhere on this planet. When the apostles got there, the Holy Spirit enabled them to speak in the tongue that they needed right at that same time. Oh, I have a question. Why don't our religious friends do that today? Why don't they do that today? Just like the apostles did. Where did the apostles ever need an inspired interpreter. They never needed one. Do you know why? Because they experienced Holy Spirit baptism. And the Holy Spirit gave them that tongue at the precise time that they needed it. Now, there's the communication. But what was the second aspect? Confirmation. Why would you listen to an apostle of Christ in the first century? They work a miracle. They're liable to strike somebody with blindness. You know, we read that in Acts 13, didn't we? But they're also liable to raise someone from the dead. Do you understand that? So what did those miracles that the apostles worked do? It confirmed the word of God. Acts 2:22. Jesus was confirmed by miracles, wonders, and signs, and they knew it. Mark 16:20, in the context of the apostles, they went everywhere preaching the word, the Lord working with them, and confirming the word with signs following. Hebrews 2, 1-4. There's no doubt. Individuals in the first century worked supernaturally with supernatural abilities from the Holy Spirit to confirm the word of God. But I want you to quickly look with me in Acts, or rather 1 Corinthians chapter 12. 1 Corinthians chapter 12. There were at least 9 main supernatural gifts of the Spirit. The Bible doesn't explicitly say this, but it is implied that all of the apostles, the 12 plus Paul, possessed all 9 of these supernatural abilities. 1 Corinthians 12 and verse number 8 beginning. For to one is given by the Spirit the word of wisdom. There's number 1. To another the word of knowledge. There's number 2. By the same Spirit. Verse 9. To another faith. Supernatural faith. By the same Spirit. To another, number 4, the gifts of healing. By the same Spirit. Verse 10. To another, number 5, the working of miracles. To another, number 6, prophecy. To another, number 7, the discerning of spirits. We'll perhaps talk about that one quickly. To another, number 8, divers or various kinds of tongues. To another, number 9, the interpretation of tongues. But look at verse 11. But all these worketh that one and the self same Spirit. That's the Holy Spirit, dividing to every man severally as he will. Here's the point. It seems that the apostles had all 9 of these. One of the 9 was the discerning of spirits. That is intentions, their motive. So the apostles could determine this individual is going to receive a supernatural ability of the Spirit. They could determine the individual, but the Spirit determined the gift or the gifts. Because it does seem that some individuals receive more than one gift. For example, Philip. He was no doubt an inspired preacher, but he could also work miracles, and they saw it. So perhaps some individuals did receive more than one gift, but the implication is that the apostles had all 9. They could determine the individual, but they didn't say this one's going to speak tongues and this one's going to interpret tongues. They determined the individual, but the Spirit himself determined the gift or gifts that were given to those individuals. Now, number 5. Holy Spirit baptism and the particular portion of time. Listen to our sentence. Holy Spirit baptism was a promise of power received by a precise group of persons for the purposes of communicating and confirming the Word of God all within a very particular period of time. Now, it should be clear that Holy Spirit baptism was supernatural. The supernatural had its day. It was within a limited amount of time. Where does the New Testament teach that? 1 Corinthians 13, verses 8 through 10. Now recall this. The apostles accomplished the commission that was given to them in their lifetime. Where does the Bible teach that? Colossians 1, 23. The gospel which was preached to every creature under heaven. So the apostles, Jesus told them, go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. Guess what they did? They did exactly that. And the apostle Paul wrote by inspiration in Colossians 1 and verse 23 and in Romans 10 and verse 18 that they had done exactly that. They had taken the whole gospel to the whole world in their lifetime. And they accomplished their commission. Therefore what? Everything of a supernatural nature occurred within the lifetime of the apostles of Christ. Don't you see that? Can you see that? They were the only ones who could lay their hands on others and give miraculous gifts. So what's the conclusion? As they naturally died off, and those on whom they laid their hands, what happened to the supernatural gifts? They died off with the apostles. No doubt. Now, written no later than AD 63, an inspired apostle of Christ, that is Paul, plainly declared that only one baptism remains. Do you understand that? Ephesians 4:5 says, one Lord, one faith, one baptism. Which one is it? If it's Holy Spirit baptism, then there's no need for water baptism. Don't you see that? It can't be both. Do you understand? It can't be both. But if water baptism is the one baptism that remains, why do you need Holy Spirit baptism? Why do you need it? It was never to save anyway, was it? No. Now, what is the one baptism that remains? It's the same baptism of Mark 16:16. He that believeth and is baptized shall be saved, but he that believeth not shall be damned. It's the same baptism of Acts 2:38. Then Peter said unto them, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins, and ye shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. It's the same baptism commanded in Acts 10 and verse 47. Peter said, can any man forbid water that these should not be baptized which have received the Holy Ghost as well as we? Do you understand? In Acts 10, perhaps there were two baptisms. But moving forward, Ephesians 4:5 says there's only one. Which one is it? Is it Holy Spirit baptism or is it water baptism? The answer is it's water baptism. That is the one baptism that remains. Holy Spirit baptism was administered by Jesus. Water baptism is administered by human beings upon or to human beings. Do you recall Matthew's account of the Great Commission, Matthew 28, beginning in verse 18? Then Jesus came and spake unto them, saying, all power, all authority is given unto me in heaven and in earth. Go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I've commanded you. And lo, I'm with you always, even to the end of the world. Amen. Do you understand? Holy Spirit baptism had to be administered by Jesus. Jesus tells the apostles, go teach everybody, and you baptize them. It's impossible for a human to baptize another human in the Holy Spirit. Therefore what? Holy Spirit baptism does not remain. Water baptism remains. And in order for water baptism to be valid, it has to be for, to get into the remission of sins. Holy Spirit baptism was a promise of power received by a precise group of persons for the purposes of communicating and confirming the Word of God all within a particular portion of time. Holy Spirit baptism never saved anyone. It never guaranteed their faithfulness either. You know why? I read Galatians 2 and Peter sinned. Peter no doubt experienced Holy Spirit baptism, but even after he experienced Holy Spirit baptism, he still sinned. And Paul rebuked him to his face. Holy Spirit baptism never guaranteed faithfulness. It does water baptism. But you've got to start somewhere. You make the final decision regarding your eternity. There will be no miracles that occur when you decide to submit to water baptism. There's nothing strange or out of the ordinary going to occur. Spiritual law will be enacted. You know what the spiritual law is? You know what it is? Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins. Paul expressed it this way in Acts 22:16, as what Ananias told him. Arise. Why tarriest thou? What are you waiting on? arise and be baptized and wash away thy sins. That's not a miracle. That's spiritual law. Where do I start? You got to hear it. Acts 18:8. Once you hear it, you got to believe it. Acts 16:31. Once you hear it and believe it, you got to repent of your sins. Acts 17:30, it's commanded of all men. Once you hear it, believe it, and repent of sins, you got to confess Jesus Christ to be the Son of God. Acts 8:37. And you're still not in Christ. You're still in your sins until you submit to being immersed in water for the remission of sins. Acts 2:38. Then you've been added by the Lord to the church. Acts 2:47. And it is your duty, as it is mine, to walk in the light faithfully unto death. Acts 14:22. Wherever you are, come now, as together we stand and as we sing the song of encouragement.